is that they also have different functions. So you can hide Goombas in special question mark blocks, which I do just to be a bit of an arse, but it's amusing when watching my friends or family play it. But you can also say take a Koopa, shake it, and it'll be in a shell, and other just sort of quirks like that. And stuff with the chain jumps is just really, really fun. Now, you may be wondering, okay, so I have all these items at my disposal. How can I control the aesthetics of the game? How can I create a level, but with a background and environment I want to work in? They thought of that. You have various sort of areas at your disposal. So there's sort of like normal ground, I can't really not describe it, underground, underwater, Bowser's Castle. I think that's all I've got so far. I'm not sure if there's any more. I don't think there's a sky one. No, I don't think there's a sky one. I don't know if I saw that anywhere. I have played the game, honest. And there's also different sort of art styles. So they've drawn upon four art styles for the game. So you can either play the original Super Mario Brothers, Super Mario Brothers 3, Super Mario World, and Super Mario Bros. U. And my favourite, personal favourite, is Super Mario World. I think the art style of that game is so beautiful, so colourful and vibrant. It's so fun to work and play around in that environment. Interestingly, the environment, the sort of art style you choose does have implications on your level, because different games have different abilities exclusive to that game. So for example, in Super Mario Bros. U, you can jump from wall to wall, wall jump. However, in Super Mario 3, Super Mario Bros. And Super Mario World, you can't do that, so you cannot use that feature in different art styles, which is quite cool. It makes you really sort of think about the game you're designing. And in a way, it does impose a sort of slight limitations, although it doesn't hinder the gameplay experience. What I enjoyed greatly from the level, as a level editor, really, is the area to which you can play. You can create in UR, you control where the flagpole is, the end flagpole is, and the level it's at. However, you can have quite a wide level, you can have quite a long level. And as you progress through the games, basically as you play each day, you can unlock warp pipes and you can move about with different depths, which is such a cool feature to have. However, there is a negative to that, which is you can't have checkpoints. There are no checkpoints in the game, which is slightly odd. So, if you're creating a relatively large level, now you are limited. You can't create a huge, expansive level. You can still die quite frequently, and it's irritating. Not irritating, it's just you notice that you don't have checkpoints placed through, like that you can place throughout the level. That's just probably a downside. It's not a crippling factor. It's not turned me off the game in the slightest. But it makes the urgency and the need to traverse carefully that much more immediate and apparent. So, once you've created your level, you then must think, what do I do with it? Well, first of all, you save. If you've ever been to a computer class, then you know to save as you go. I cannot imagine how irritating it would be to get through, start like be making a really good level, and then say a power cut or something, and then you've lost it. That would be truly awful. But once you've saved it, you can then upload it, and the uploading process is really easy. You create a name for your level, best to keep it clean, and then it's out there for others to play. Now we'll talk about that in a little bit. I just want to talk about more about the interface and some like little secrets you may not know. this, but it actually takes some influence from Mario Paint, a game that came out a while ago, 1993 or 2. And the influence there is, I believe, the dog, which you do to undo. And I think maybe the robot. I'm not sure. But basically, the dog makes you undo a recent change. And then the robot is like a menu, which lets you go to different areas of the game. But there's also a rocket, and a rocket basically just destroys everything. Can you go back to the beginning? It's a reset button, and I've used that many a time, too many for my liking. But what you'll notice, if you stand idle for too long, these flies appear, and if you tap them, like a fly swat, it's awesome. And what I didn't realise is that it then takes you to a mini game where you have to kill loads of flies, and I haven't been able to complete it yet, but I've heard there's like, you get some stuff from completing it. It's quite a fun little mini game. It just shows that this game is full of little secrets and really fun things. Now, you know I like Amiibo. Well, I slightly like them. You know the deal. Now, I haven't been able to because I don't unbox them, unfortunately, but there is such awesome Amiibo support. Well, I say such awesome Amiibo support. Basically, if you get the base of the Amiibo and touch it to the gamepad like you're probably familiar with, you can play with that sprite, which is super cool. Now, I can't say too much about this because I haven't personally experienced it, but I'm aware of it as a feature, so you guys should know as well. So if you want to finally really use that Amiibo, that is a way for you to do it. So, I would definitely recommend, when creating a level, to use the gamepad. It's easiest and it seems to be the smoothest. However, you can also use, I'll just check the back of the box, it doesn't say, but I believe you can use the Wii U Pro controller, and I think you can use a Wii controller, I think. No, don't hold me on that, because I've just used the gamepad. I'm just trying to recall from looking at the box. That's cool, but that just seems to be, it seems like it wouldn't be as fluid. So stick to the gamepad. It's funny, you know, people said it wasn't useful. Fools. So yeah, that's all I really want to talk about when talking about the level editor, which is basically the main portion of the game. This next bit is the sort of online after you've uploaded. So once you upload a level, it's available for other people to play. And once they've, and if someone plays it, they can you get a notification, and they can rate it and leave a comment. However, what you're probably going to be more interested in is playing other people's levels. There are so many awesome, crazy levels that you would never think of, and they are great for drawing upon inspiration. And they're so easy to access and quick, probably depending on your internet, but still seamless. I was playing, I was looking at the leaderboard, because it seems there's a leaderboard of like the top 50 like highest rated creators. And there's this Japanese guy, based purely off his Mii and the flag, and his level was called Do Not Move. And I didn't know what to do, but I did follow the instruction. And then you got in the level, and then various things happened that made your character move. And it was so, the whole scene was, it is so insane. And your characters moved about, and then finally got to the end. It was so theatrical, so exciting. It was awesome. I just wanted to replay it and replay it, although I wasn't really playing it. But you know what I mean. So that's so awesome that there's such a wealth of levels available for you to try and experience and gain inspiration from. There is such, I can imagine this growing to be such a huge community for this game. So many people coming together, sharing ideas and making such awesome levels. This game is a true gem for anyone who likes Minecraft or just Mario. It's a Mario's Nerdvana. Well, that sounded cliche. Try ignore that. Another thing to point out, there are 10 challenges. I've delved a bit into it, not too greatly, but they're quite fun to do. It adds a bit extra to it. Now we've sort of talked about this is a reason to buy the game. I mean, this game is a reason to buy a Wii U. This is such a concentrated and action and a really full package of a game. There is so much to do. You can spend countless hours creating, playing, deconstructing levels, and perfecting, maybe finding that perfect level, the perfect difficulty, or just being an absolute dick and making it impossible to complete. This game is going to keep you playing for hours. And for that reason, if I had to give it a rating out of 10, 9 out of 10, just because, I don't know, why am I giving it 9? It is a very polished game. But I just think it's little things like, say, a lack of checkpoints, maybe. It's little bits like that that doesn't give it a 10. So, get this game. You are going to plow hours into it. So, guys, I hope you enjoyed this review. Sorry if it seems to be a bit choppy. There are a lot of noises going on around me because I'm having to film during the day. An ASMR creator's nightmare. But hopefully you can overlook that and still I'll do my best to edit this video to be as relaxing as possible. If you did manage to enjoy this video, please leave a like and definitely leave a comment down below and I can get back in touch with you. Once again, thank you for 8,000 subscribers. It is phenomenal and insane. I can barely comprehend it. You guys mean so much to me and allow me to do so much, and we, as of the ASMR gamer community, I don't want that to sound pretentious, I mean that in a very loving and communal way. I think we're getting to know each other so well and I'm blessed for it. More videos coming next week, yes. It's been very game-centric in the past couple weeks. Obviously, I'm the ASMR gamer, so that is a positive. Although I know others look for different content, so next week is going to have a bit of game content and a bit more classic ASMR. But either way, I hope you have a very good evening, a relaxing one, and help you drift off to sleep. Or if you're still working and listening to this while working twice, I hope you can unwind and chill and be positive, be in a positive mental state, and be as productive as possible. I hope to see you guys in the next video. Lots of love as always. Goodbye.